This is to inform the public about the rules that currently govern the members of parliament and senators' use of public of funds, goods, services, and the separate rules that govern their conduct in terms of conflict of interest and ethics, as well as mechanisms in place to monitor this conduct. So basically, we're going to be talking about bad politicians, in a sense. But this panel will also talk about reforms are necessary or if they're possible. So we've divided the event into five sections, about 15 to 20 minutes each. Section one is introductions and explanations of roles. Section two, what are the rules that currently guide the conduct of MPs and senators as parliamentarians? Section three, what happens when rules are broken? Section four, do we need to reform the current rules and mechanisms? And section five is audience questions. So essentially, each panelist should be allocated a certain amount of time to respond to all topics and questions. I'll try to keep things on track. I have a stopwatch here that I'm told I'm supposed to use, but I don't really, I've never really done this, so bear with me. All right. So let's get going. So first of all, I guess the question I wanted to ask you both, just to give each a presentation outlining their and their offices' roles regarding maintenance of ethics and integrity in the Canadian government. Ms. Dawson.
Okay, well, I'm responsible to administer one piece of legislation and one code, the Conflict of Interest Act for public office holders and the members' code of ethics. The first one applies to a number of different people. It applies to ministers, parliamentary secretaries, ministerial staff, and governor and council appointees. They number about 2,500, yeah. Then the code, of course, is the 338 members that I'm administering.
You poor lamb.
So basically, how it's organized is when they become either a public office holder or a member, they're responsible to submit a series of answers to a bunch of confidential questions, confidential information. And on the basis of that, a certain amount of that information is made public. They have deadlines within which to submit the information. And so that there's public scrutiny of their basic holdings. We don't give detailed information. For example, we'd say they own something worth more than $10,000 or something. We don't say how much. There's a whole series of conflict of interest rules that they must comply with. And they're basically built on the concept of conflict of interest, which is defined to mean taking advantage of their public position for private interests, either their own, their family,
right,
or improperly for somebody else. And the only thing that's not under that rubric is the gift rules, which are really part of conflict of interest as well. There's similar rules in both the code and the act. And then I have the power to investigate infractions and submit reports on them. And so that's basically the panoply. I'm unusual in the sense that most ethics commissions don't have both the investigatory and the advisory role. And I consider my main role to be advisory, and educational. I think the educational part of the role is manifested both in the advice we give them, the public reports that I make every year, because I do quite fulsome annual reports as to what's going on, and also the reports that I submit on the various investigations that I've done. So that's kind of it in a nutshell of what my job is.
Typically, how many investigations do you do a year? Does that have interest?
It varies quite a bit, but I'd say somewhere in the order of, depends on the ones that I report on. I've had in my time, which is about 8.5 years, over 200 files that I've opened. I've made, I think, 29 reports. So sometimes I don't proceed with the files I've opened, and sometimes I discontinue, but anyway, I've issued 29 reports.
Mr. Ferguson.
Maybe a few things. First of all, I'm one of the people that has to file information with
yes,
with the commissioner's office because of the nature of my appointment. She hasn't had to investigate, just to clear that up.
So far.
So far.
So far. Give it time.
You know, in terms of sort of the role of the Office of the Auditor General, as it relates to parliamentarians per se, I suppose I could cut this very short and say we don't have one. but what I mean by that is we don't have any legal mandate about, you know, doing any work in terms of the, you know, members of the House of Commons or the Senate. We have done, though, some work from time to time, some audits from time to time in the institutions, but we only do that when we are invited, as opposed to all of the other work that we do where we manage to invite ourselves in. When we're dealing with the House of Commons or the Senate, we have to be invited in. So in 2012, we did an audit of the administration of the House of Commons and an audit of the administration of the Senate. So those audits were really about how the folks in the administrative roles, you know, how do they execute those roles? Are they doing what they're supposed to be doing in terms of, you know, letting out contracts or hiring or overseeing the spending of members or senators? But in the course, you know, so we were invited in to do that audit of the administration, but we were not invited in at that time to do an audit of the actual spending of members or senators, okay? So we issued those reports, and those reports, again, were simply reports about how the administration conducts its business. Then, of course, you know, there were a few senators that got themselves in the news over their spending practices.
You're kidding.
Mm-hmm. people may have heard of that. And we were invited in by the Senate to do a comprehensive audit of all senators' spending. And we, in that case, we were given the latitude to set the scope of the audit however we wanted to. So that was really unprecedented from the point of view of it was the first time, I think, that yeah. The Auditor General's office was invited in and said, okay, you come in and just look at whatever you need to look at. You know, and we issued the report on senator spending in 2015, yeah. In June of 2015, just before the House rose. Now, in terms, though, of our overall mandate, you know, we conduct performance audits. Those are the things people know us for. You know, when we release a report, it's those performance audits that look at how government programs are being carried out and those types of things. Half of our business, though, is also on financial audits. So, you know, audits of the set of financial statements of either the Government of Canada or Crown corporations. And within that mandate, we do what are called special examinations of Crown corporations, where we look at the practices that exist in those Crown corporations to see whether they have the practices that they should have about managing themselves. So part of that, we will often look at their governance structure, including whether they have things like a code of conduct, how they put that right. Code of conduct in place, you know, how do they deal with ethics issues and that type of thing. We also have another obscure mandate actually related to the Public Sector Integrity Commissioner. So the Public Sector Integrity Commissioner, you know, when civil servants have an issue with the way that things are going on, you know, in their department or in the government, they can bring that to the attention of the Public Sector Integrity Commissioner, who will investigate that. You know, it's sort of the whistleblower, colloquially known as the whistleblower process. So, you know, if there's a civil servant that wants to bring something forward, they do that to the Public Sector Integrity Commissioner. But there's a bit of the act that says, but if somebody's complaining about how the Public Sector Integrity Commissioner is doing their work, then that comes to us.
How do I complain about you?
Well, there's a lot of that that goes on. Yeah,
to me.
And in fact, we have had to do a couple of we've had to do a couple of investigations at the Public Sector Integrity Commissioner. So our role in terms of this whole thing is a little bit all over the map. It isn't, you know, one that is set in legislation about, you know, this is what we do. We have to sort of try and weasel our way into you know, looking at things in either the House of Commons or the Senate.
One of the observations I came away with at the tail end of the Harper government was that governments, regardless of political stripe, they sort of eventually become the thing that they hate or that they say they hate. There's a very long sort of history of this, so I'll limit to myself to the stuff I remember. I'm going to date myself here, but whatever, I was pretty young. I remember seeing the debate between Prime Minister John Turner and the upstart progressive conservative Brian Mulroney in 1984, where that famous line came out, you know, you had an option, sir. Which essentially won Mulroney the election. He was talking about liberal patronage appointments to the Senate, judiciary, crown corporations, et cetera, et cetera. It was a great line, and Mulroney swore up and down that he wouldn't commit, as writer Peter C. Newman put it gloriously, I think, an orgy of patronage. But then you fast forward 10 years, and Mulroney had committed several patronage orgies by that point, among many other sins that are probably too numerous to lay out tonight. Chrétien, you know, came along 10 years later and said he was going to do away with a lot of the stuff that Mulroney did. 10 years later, we had AdScam. Harper came in and promised an open and accountable government with massive Senate reform. And while there was some movement in terms of proactive disclosure for MPs earlier on, it's difficult to say that this government is particularly open. As for the Senate, Harper hated it at the beginning, and midway through he was using it essentially as part of his re-election campaign. So to a certain extent, there was a sense of deja vu to me anyway, to the recent outrage over Senate expenses and the like. And there was almost as much hypocrisy in the Liberals' own outrage as there was in the Conservatives. I mean, after all, a cynic could say they were both basically, they took their turns at the trough. What I'm wondering is, like, how do you put an end to that cycle? I mean, we obviously have structures in place within the government and bodies such as yours to deal with it. Can you put an end to it? Like, how do you minimize it to the most that you can?
I don't think there's a body that is responsible for overseeing that, the appointments or that kind of activity. Basically, I should say one thing. I don't think Harper talked about open and accountable government. He talked about accountable government, and that's the big difference that Prime Minister Trudeau is trying to distinguish himself from Mr. Harper.
But at the beginning, he was on, he did talk about proactive disclosure in terms of expenses.
Well, he was the instigator of the act that
that
made my office. I think that was accountability, but I don't want to quibble on that. That's not a big deal. But it's interesting that you use that phrase, though, because the Prime Minister's, Trudeau's, guideline for parliamentarians is called open and accountable government, and Harper's was only called accountable government, and he's touting that as the big change, which is why I made mention of that.
Right.
Yeah. Anyway, I've lost track of what the question was.
So how do you put an end to that cycle?
Well, I don't know that... that's an easy question to answer, because it's really human behavior, and it's in the area that is really guarded by the executive in charge. And there's it's not a matter of personal ethics, for example, or personal behavior as such, and it's done confidentially. There's no discussion of how they go about making the appointments. I guess the obvious way is to appoint, and that's what I guess Prime Minister Trudeau is trying to do, is appointing a separate group that will decide how to appoint the next group of senators.
Right.
And so it's to distance yourself at least from the pool that you're choosing from, I would think.
Hopefully it is nonpartisan, right?
We'll see how that works over the years, but hopefully that will help.
I guess sort of from my point of view, I'm an auditor, so I always wait until things are happening before sort of I give an opinion on them, right?
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
Governments always come forward with ways they want to deal with things, and, you know, that's all fine and good. Mm-hmm. We'll wait until they're actually in place and mm-hmm. put it to the test and see how they're operating. I think, maybe the one thing you know, that your question sort of raises a whole bunch of different parts of it. One thing that we noticed, again, in the audit that we did of senators' spending was fundamentally one of the problems was senators, through the internal economy committee in the Senate, they set the rules. When there's a question about somebody spending, it goes to that committee, which is made up of senators. The people that are sitting on that committee are people that are putting in claims themselves, right? So whatever decisions they're making, you know, people could be, you know, people could have the impression that, well, maybe they're making that decision taking into account their own circumstances, not just sort of looking at it from an independent point of view. Before we did that report, actually, in 2013, we appeared before a committee in the House of Commons talking about, you know, transparency and accountability and things around members' expenses.
Yeah.
And made the same observation, right? That, again, it was the people that were putting claims in and things are the same people making the rules and the same people deciding on, you know, cases where, you know, there's a question about the spending. So, you know, and we've asked for a mandate. We've asked for a, you know, some sort of a mandate that is defined. It's not one that we have to go forward every so often and say, will you please invite us in, but that we would have an actual mandate. There's, you know, and that question actually has been asked by auditors general since the very first auditor general. You know, that's been a long-standing concern of auditors general about getting the ability to look at that part of spending. And, you know, it's always that you're dealing with people that are, you know, making the decisions that you would be auditing that don't really want to be audited.
Right.
That are always sort of trying to send the signal of, oh, yes, we should be doing more about this. And by the way, why don't you come in and look at how the administration is doing their work?
Yeah, and it's interesting in your situation, and perhaps Mrs. Dawson's as well, is that the Senate business that we were talking about before, where you were invited in, that was a matter of political pressure for them. In other words, if they had said, you can't come in and look at this, they would have been destroyed politically. It would have looked horrible for them. And arguably, that's the reason that you were allowed to go in, which is kind of absurd.
Well, it's said that, you know, the advances in the rules are usually as a result of a crisis. Like all the changes that were done, my new Ethics Act came out in 2006, and it was a result of preceding crises like Airbus and stuff.
Right.
There's two or three of them. And, you know, that's how advances get made in these kind of rules, generally. It's a fact of life. You know, it takes a misbehavior to get a reaction to then get better rules.
So you could almost look at the...
You can track, actually, quite often, the advances.
I hadn't thought of it. I mean, I'm so cynical about this stuff, I hadn't even thought of it that way.
But they do have a benefit sometimes.
Yeah, I was just going to say, so that's the glass half full aspect of it, then.
Yeah.
We've also done a number of audits in the past, or at least one audit in the... Well, a number of audits in the past of, let's call them sort of small organizations where something has gone off the rails with the way that it's been managed. And I think sort of one that people here would be familiar with was one that we did with the Auditor General of Quebec about the Lieutenant Governor in Quebec.
Yeah, Thibault.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, and before that, you know, we had done, you know, a number of other audits about that, and it culminated in an audit of governor and council appointment process. You know, looking at that whole process about how people are appointed through that GIC process. Now, full disclosure, the Auditor General is appointed through that process as well.
Right.
So I'm a
product.
A governor and council appointment. But, you know, time and time again, the problem with those types of appointments often, you know, of people coming from the outside that, you know, haven't worked in the government world, they don't understand everything about the government world. They don't understand, you know, the ethics and the integrity that the rules that exist. And oftentimes they think that they can just continue to operate, you know, that they're operating their own shop and they can operate it however they want. sort of regardless of the rules. And I think that's one thing that causes, you know, this stuff to go off the rails sometimes is the people that are appointed, you know, don't always understand what is expected of them once they become part of the public service.
Huh, interesting. Mm-hmm. What was the question I wanted to ask you about that? Yeah, just so a couple of things that Trudeau has done so far. There was the audit, your audit was pre-election, of course, June 2015. Justin Trudeau's private member's bill last parliament, which proposed to open up the Board of Internal Economy, and the Liberal Party platform basically said the same thing. Then Trudeau, during the campaign, said often that he would support, quote, support an Auditor General review of all MPs' expenses. What's your, I'd like just to get your individual takes on that yourself.
Well, I think those are all, you know, excellent suggestions. I've had problems with the Board of Internal Economy too, because I can't get information because everything is confidential. There's no reports and stuff, and it's sort of symptomatic of the whole way that the House of Commons and the Senate look at themselves, because they're, you know, they can't be reviewed by the courts. They have their own rules, and so, for example, I've tried to get emails and things from the House of Commons and had problems with that, and ultimately I finally got some in one of my investigations but they said it had to go through the person that was accused of having contravened the act before I could get it. And
again, another conflict of interest.
Right, and so I think opening up even to public meetings of the Board of Internal Economy would be a great advance, so that you can see what, because everything's confidential and there's no reports that come out of it.
So sunlight's the best detergent, I guess.
I think so. But
Mr. Ferguson?
Again, I'll go to the recommendations we made as a result of the Senate audit. And in fact, we had made, like you say, very similar recommendations in 2013 when I appeared before a House of Commons committee. But, you know, in case of the Senate one, and here you're talking about the Senate Standing Committee on Internal Economy, Budgets, and Administration. And, you know, we said that the Senate should look at that with the objective of creating independent oversight of senators' expenses. And, you know, that there should be, you know, the meeting should be open to the public. You know, and that there should be some way of that committee not just being senators making decisions about senators, either make it totally independent or give it some membership on there that is independent. So, you know, making that whole process open to the public, I think, is something that's important, and we've been on record twice as talking about that.
What I wonder, though, and you bring up a good point. You were before the wave and after the wave, and you arguably caused the wave in the sense of the Senate scandal. How much pushback did you get from those recommendations, and when you made them in 2013, and when you made them in 2015, in terms of?
I'll reserve judgment in terms of what we said in 2015, because again, we tabled the report in June. Parliament was dissolved, before the election, really, you know, the Senate's just sort of getting back up and running, and the committee's running now, and, you know, okay, they have to go through that. So, you know, I'll still give them a little bit of time to be able to consider the recommendations and come up with something. I appeared before a committee in 2013, committee in the House of Commons, talked about the fact that they needed to improve their practices in terms of transparency, in terms of oversight, you know, having governance, having some independence in that oversight, and in terms of accountability, right, that they needed to improve all of their practices in those areas. We were very politely listened to. At the end of the day, I think if you look at the recommendation that came out of it, it said things like inviting the Auditor General in to do periodic audits has worked well.
Thanks.
Right. You know, and from our point of view, no, it hasn't worked well, because We have to wait to be invited in, number one, and number two, they tell us what we can look at, right? Anywhere else, we decide when we're going in, and we say this is what we're going to be auditing, right? So, you know, that one, like I say, we talked about it, that in 2013. They said that they were going to work on some guidelines for the type of role that the Auditor General should have related to spending of the House of Commons, and we've had zero conversations with anybody on it since then, and like I say, those hearings were late 2013.
It brings up the sort of the House-Senate dichotomy, if I can use a $10 word. It's an interesting one. You know, I'm not really against the Senate per se, and I don't, a lot of people aren't. The idea of having politicians being able to legislate without the constant and sort of arguably corrosive worry of being reelected is probably a good thing. But the resulting rules for the Senate are weirdly contradictory. You know, they're seemingly more vague because senators are assumed to conduct themselves as gentlemen, and yes, by and large, they're gentlemen, who are supposedly above the vulgarities of, you know, partisan electoral politics. Yet the process by which senators are appointed is such that appointees tend to be the most hidebound and sort of slavish of partisans. That's the nature of it. You know, the Duffy trial was the ultimate example of this for me. You know, put aside his expenses for a second. The real scandal that I saw was the fundraising videos that he was doing with Pamela Wallen in the lead up to the 2011 election, and how a huge chunk of his expenses didn't derive from any business of the Senate, legitimate or not, but that they were these nakedly partisan events where he sort of pushed the conservative brand. Then there's the House of Commons. As Joan Bryden wrote in the Canadian press last year, more than twice as many MPs have been accused of improperly spending more than four times the amount Ferguson concluded was misspent by the 30 senators. Recent reports by Ms. Dawson found that MPs and public office holders have breached the code in the act. So I guess first to Mr. Ferguson, in the House of Commons, oversight and accountability and transparency exist, right? We're more or less.
They need to improve. Uh-huh. You know what, where they are on transparency, on governance, and on accountability. They need to have some independence in that whole decision making process. Oddly enough, I guess, or maybe just so people are aware of a couple of things, right? I mean, you sort of said, you know, the Senate, we never comment on policy, mm-hmm. right? We don't comment on government policy. Government policy is whatever it is. We comment on how it's been implemented, right? But when we did the audit of the Senate, one of the things we had to spend a lot of time on was making sure we understood what the role of a senator was. And other than, I believe, in the direct election period, you know, we accepted that senators do in fact have a partisan role to play. They are party members, and there's a certain partisan role that they have to play, and some of that is acceptable. So we had to sort of get that whole understanding. But there's a lot more that both institutions can do in terms of transparency, governance, and accountability. The recommendations that we made in the audit of senators' spending were a lot more granular, if you want, than our normal recommendations. We sort of went down to a level of detail that we don't normally go to. That was to impress on them that, you know, this wasn't just a matter of us saying you should be more transparent. Right, because they could always come back and say, yes, you know, we're committed to transparency and we're going
blah,
to
blah, blah.
Right.
Right.
So we said, you know, you should be more transparent and you should disclose things such as, right? And we gave a list of the types of things that we would expect them to disclose. I think maybe the thing that concerns me the most and that baffles me the most is you would think by now, and you can look at what happened in the legislature in Newfoundland and what happened, you know, members of the House of Assembly in Newfoundland and the legislature in Nova Scotia and things, right? Now what's been happening with senators here, you know, you would really think that everybody in both the House of Commons and the Senate right now would say, okay, we need to get this right. You know, we need to We need to make sure it's clear. You know, we need to make sure that we are being transparent. You know, one of the things, and I don't know, you may get to this later on, but one of the other things that we looked at when we looked at senator spending was, okay, we looked at the rules and said, okay, you know, there are rules here. Did they comply with the rules or did they not? But fundamentally, we took everything up a level, right? And we said, you know, you can't take these things just down to the level of rules, because once you get into rules, you know, people will always find ways to get around rules.
Yes, exactly.
Right.
So get around the language, in other words.
Right. Yeah. So we said you got to take it up to another level, which is the principle of, you know, behind those rules. But, you know, in terms of sort of that whole question of are they accountable enough, are they transparent enough, all of those types of things, there's more that they need to do on that. And really, you would think by now that they would, you know, really focus their mind on that and say, we're going to put in place a really good accountability and transparency regime whereby people also have confidence that the decisions that are being made are being made, you know, in an objective manner. But they're not there yet.
I'm going to put that question to you. Why not?
Why not? Well, you know what? I can't comment on that, really. But let me just say, you know, I'm in a different domain. This discussion has really not got much to do with the stuff that I'm dealing with. I deal with individuals. I don't deal with systems. I don't deal with the organization within either the House of Commons or the Senate of people's expenditures and things like that. In fact, it's expressly carved out of my act. I've got a section that says all the stuff that has to do with the management of resources in the House of Commons is the domain of the Board of Internal Economy, and keep your hands off. So my domain is sort of the converse of the Auditor General's domain. I'm looking at personal, private behavior, which isn't what's going on in the institutions.
That's where it starts.
Well, not really, because I'm not looking at the management of the resources within the House. I'm looking at the personal use of a position, and my evidence and my information that I'm looking for, mm-hmm. is outside the House, not inside the House.
I see what you mean. Okay.
So I'm in a quite a different domain than the one we've been talking about, basically.
But as far as like conflict of interest and things like that, since your appointment, you've been, it's 7, 8
years? 07.
07?
Yeah.
What's been the transition in terms of awareness amongst MPs to
the rules and
to
things?
To the rules, I to what they should and shouldn't do.
I think it's been quite good. I think the efforts that my office makes is to educate them. I'm going through an interesting time right now because we've got all new members, but they're extremely receptive to learning what the rules are.
Right.
I've been invited to both the Liberal and the Conservative caucus already to lay out the rules. And of course, the way my office works is that everybody has to put in information. So therefore, everybody is assigned an advisor, and there's one-on-one information flow between every single of the 2,500 that are under my act and the advisor. So we just are in a quite a different domain from the one that Mr. Ferguson has to deal with. He's looking at systemic things more. I'm looking at individual issues.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
But there's a bit of overlap in the sense that it's common sense. Just there's some things you shouldn't, like for the questions of expenses. You should know that if I have a house in Ottawa and I live mm-hmm. within 100 mm-hmm. kilometers of Ottawa,
mm-hmm.
and I have a house somewhere else in PEI, for example.
Right. just for example.
Just throwing that out there. That maybe the rules in place aren't there for me to try to get around or gin up or anything like this.
Right.
The same way that I shouldn't use my position as an MP to further my own personal interests.
Right.
And
well,
yet it happens all the time.
Well,
happens all the time. Happens a fair bit.
Right. And that's true. And it shouldn't happen all the time. But the trouble is the people that are overseeing it are the Board of Internal Economy.
Which is exactly what you were saying.
Yes. So if they had somebody else overseeing it, it would be better. Or at least if they made public what it was they were saying about it. So, I mean, that therein lies the problem. But it's not the area that that I deal with. Mm-hmm. I'm more concerned with taking personal advantage of your position,
position.
To benefit either yourself or your friends or things like that, which is not what you're involved
right,
in.
Right, no, and actually sort of when I was thinking about all of this, right, that was part of sort of what came out of it was, you know, when you're looking at things like ethics and integrity you know, probably accountability, those you can set rules around them and people have to follow the rules. But fundamentally, it's all only going to work if each individual is committed to those things,
yeah.
Right? Those are personal,
right.
That's part of the personal makeup, right? And I mean, everybody's going to make a mistake, right? But I mean, fundamentally, people need to be committed to the ethics, the integrity, and the accountability. Mm-hmm. Then when you look at things like, you know, governance and, you know, what should be reported and all of those types of things, those are institutional things, you know, really trying to coerce, if you want, the individual to, you know, realize they have to pay attention to the ethics, the integrity, and the accountability side of things. So there really is two parts to it, right? There's in all of this stuff. There's the individual and the individual commitment,
mm-hmm. right, mm-hmm.
to saying, okay, you know, I'm involved in, you know, I've got a mandate to the public, and I need to react in a certain way because of that, and you know the money that I am entrusted with is not money that I'm just sort of out earning myself, so I get to do whatever I want with it. It's money that has been provided, and people expect it to be used for a certain reason, and want to see results out of it, right? So I mean, you got to have that personal commitment to it all, and then you build the system around all of that as well.
One flows from the other
to try to convince yeah. and help people, you know, live up to that standard.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned though that you'd think that people have gotten it by now. Why haven't they?
Well, they're not all the same people, for one thing. I mean, there's a constant flow. The other thing is that the people that
change every 4 years, I guess.
Yeah, but the other thing about it is that the old timers are harder to convince than the newcomers, as a matter of fact, because they're used to living in the domain of the where there weren't rules.
Yeah.
I mean, gradually that's disappearing as people die off and a younger one could come in. But I mean, there's been quite a change in the last 10 or 20, 30 years in the whole philosophy. I mean, you know, one talks about the old boys club and
yeah.
stuff. Well, that's changing.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm finding it very refreshing. All the new MPs that have come in, I've had dealings with a lot of them now. And, you know, they want to do the right thing and they want to understand the rules and they want to do it right.
Yeah.
And I don't get resistance on the gift rules, for example, from the younger ones. I get some resistance from the older ones.
I will say the last 2011 election, the NDP had whatever it was. It was all in Quebec. It was something like 52
yeah.
Rookie MPs. And I was just like, this is going to be a gong show.
Yeah,
like,
well, it's 200 and some odd now new.
Yeah, But if you look at the record of those of the NDP, I was proven wrong. There was hardly any sort of scandal that came out about them, which was, I guess, goes to your point.
Yeah, when they're fresh and new, and in this day and age, they're anxious to do the right thing.
Right.
I think the other part of the environment is I'm not sure whether I'm going to blame the media here or just sort of talk about it a little. But anyway,
Do whatever you want.
Yeah. You know, those types of stories about people mismanaging public funds for their own benefit are, you know, ones that attract eyes, right? You know, people will get interested in that and can be outraged about it and so on. I think every time that there is one of those stories, in fact, what it ends up doing is it keeps sort of dropping the threshold, right? You know, our threshold for scandal sort of keeps dropping and dropping.
Really?
Mm-hmm. I think it does. And so what that means is people that were working in an environment where something used to be acceptable, mm-hmm. You know, now all of a sudden we'll find out, oh, okay, I'm all of a sudden in the newspaper over something because it's no longer considered acceptable.
Can you give me an example?
Not really. It's
I win.
I didn't do the audit on it. that's just sort of a perception, right? I suppose you could even go to the minister that got in trouble over the $16 orange juice.
Bev Oda.
Right.
Right.
Let's face it, if you save the federal government $16 million, $16, you're not exactly saving $16 million. You're not exactly going to make a dent in the deficit. But everybody can be outraged over a $16 orange juice, right?
That's the conservative. I mean, the conservatives came in with this idea that they're going to be frugal and just and not be the spendthrift liberals. So it looks terrible for their brand if their MP's drinking a $16 orange juice.
Right, but it sort of now sets a standard for everybody. Right, every time there's one of those, there's one of those things that are in the newspaper, it sets sort of the new threshold for behavior.
So $14 orange juice.
Well. Right. So I don't. Right. So, but again,
I see what you're saying.
You have some
you
people that have lived in the old world and have been doing some things, claiming some things, whatever, and they don't always adjust to the fact that the threshold is changing
right.
either.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And it's a question I want to put to both of you, starting with Ms. Dawson. How does the Canadian, as far as what you do, mm-hmm. how does the Canadian system compared to what other countries do in your jurisdiction?
Generally speaking, it's one of the most progressive systems, always has been. The ethics rules just came in around the 70s, basically, and gradually it came in. But I know that I've had many international visitors that have come to consult on our system. And in many countries, they haven't got past the corruption problem, let alone, you know, the heavier problems. So, but
the more granular stuff.
Yeah, but in the for example, in the United States or UK, they have similar systems to ours. But I don't think they're as powerful as ours. Like I've actually got quite a broader range of powers than the people that look after those issues in the States. And it depends, actually, in the States there's a huge variety of where they are, because there's all the states have their own systems, and then there's the federal one too.
Right.
And the federal one has one person in charge of kind of the central, but they've got hundreds and hundreds of people administering it all over the place, so it's different from our system. I believe undoubtedly Australia and New Zealand are probably on the forefront. They usually are, and I suspect that the Scandinavian countries may well be, because they're traditionally the progressive ones. They were in access to information and a number of other areas too. But Canadians and all the provincial governments stand up very well if you look at it internationally, particularly comparing it to Europe, for example, the European countries, aside from the UK.
Huh.
Yeah.
Mr. Ferguson?
Well, I guess sort of it depends what aspect you're talking about. I mean, in terms of our overall work as an Auditor General, we have sort of as mature a system and, you know, access to things as anybody, right? So, we will get same thing, right? We'll get lots of international visitors coming, because we are considered to be, in the forefront of audit practice. In terms of sort of access to spending of, members of parliament or spending of senators, we're probably no worse than most. Although, again, I think what's happened, you can look at the United Kingdom, for example, where a few years ago they had a scandal around spending, right, that caused them to put in some some rules, you know, that involve a bit more, you know, external oversight of what's going on and that type of thing. So, you know, probably the countries that are sort of further ahead on including more transparency, more oversight, and those types of things are back to the ones that have probably had, you know, big problems around it at some point in time.
The fact, you made mention of it a couple of times, the fact that you have to be invited in, how normal is that comparatively?
I can't really say, because I've never sort of tried to take a poll of it. So it's not something I can really comment on.
You know, an interesting thing is that I never have any difficulty getting evidence or information from anybody. Like, I have the power to summons. I never have to resort to summonsing. So certainly the people that are under my jurisdiction they respect the office, and they believe that it's a good thing to be, and nobody fights giving me the information.
And that's, you know, one of the things that we noted in the way that the Senate was handling expenses was, you know, there were some senators who, when they would put in their claim to be reimbursed, they would just write on it Senate business, right? There was no other explanation about what they were doing. It was just Senate business.
Right.
And the administration couldn't get back and look at all of the details behind that, right? So, you know, having that type of an environment where, you know, people have authority, you know, they have the legislative authority to look at things. I think all of that's a very important part of, you know, building the right system around these things.
Yeah.
Writing Senate system on something, it covers a lot of sin, doesn't it? To Ms. Ferguson, what qualifies as misuse of funds? What qualifies as justifiable, reasonable, and appropriate?
Mr. Ferguson or Mrs. Dawson?
I just call you Mrs. Ferguson.
In terms of the things that we looked at, you know, again, we had to first get an understanding, you know, in the case of the audit of senators' spending, we had to first get an understanding of what is Senate business, right? What's a parliamentary function? What's parliamentary business? We had to understand that, because the rules of the Senate said that the spending had to be for parliamentary functions, and they also said that senators were accountable for them, right?
Right.
They had to be able to demonstrate, you know, what they spent the money on. So you know, really, that's what we ended up looking at, and we took a very broad interpretation of Senate business and Senate functions. But we said, you know what, if something is purely for personal reasons, or if it's for your outside personal business interest, those things aren't Senate business, okay? So, you know, again, sort of back to the point I was making earlier, you know, I think it's always dangerous if we're trying to bring these things down to specific rules.
Right.
You know, because if there's a specific rule, I guess my view of it is, if there's a specific rule and you are offside that rule, then you're offside and you need to fix it. If you're onside the rule, that doesn't necessarily mean that you should have done what you did. For example, you could have a rule that says you can be reimbursed for taxi fares, right? Well, if I give the taxi driver a $1,000 tip, should I charge that, you know, to the government? You know, you say, well, no, wait a minute. You got to look at it also from the point of view of good use of taxpayers' dollars. So I might be onside the rule as it is written, but I'm still offside what I should do. So we look at things from an administrative point of view.
Right.
Right.
Have you actually seen that where people?
No, I have. No, that was not a real example. No.
But I mean, like, I know it was an exaggeration, but right. I was just wondering, like,
cause but you know, in under my regime, that would be a contravention. Because you're not allowed to use, mine is looking at the individual behavior. You're not allowed to use your position to advance your personal gain. If I was given a case like that, I'd find they'd contravened. Mm-hmm. Whereas it might not fit into your
Well, again, scheme. You know, it might be okay in terms of the written. This is what you're allowed to claim. This is what you're allowed to be reimbursed for.
Yeah.
But we would still raise it and say, you know, because again, when we looked at the, you know, in that audit, we said, well, one of the criteria has to be due regard for, you know, for public money, for how public money is spent.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there had to be a reasonable attempt at sort of saying, okay, we are treating the public money the way that it should be treated.
Mm-hmm. The question for you, does conflict of interest mean the same thing as corruption?
No, not at all. Corruption is, it's a criminal offense to begin with, but conflict of interest is much different. It's just a different concept. It's when you're the sort of the definition of conflict of interest is when you use your public position for a private gain.
Right.
Whereas corruption is misusing the situation. I mean, there's similarities, but corruption is more is in a sense more serious than a contravention of a usually
you
than
can
a
in
conflict
fact
of
you
interest.
Can you can be in a conflict of interest, you know, and that will happen, you know, and that's why boards and things have to have policies around conflict of interest, right? You could be on a board of something and all of a sudden find yourself in a conflict of interest because of a certain transaction
that comes forward. You've done nothing wrong.
You've done,
just recuse.
Right. You just need
Paul
to
Martin,
say,
for example.
Yeah.
You just need to say, okay, wait a minute. You know, I would have a conflict here,
and
the organization has to have rules about what you have to do. Doesn't mean you have to resign. Doesn't mean
right.
Yeah. You just
recuse yourself.
All of those types of things, right?
Yeah.
Do you ascribe to this question for both of you? Do you ascribe to the slippery slope argument in that if I do one small little thing, it's going to lead to me doing bigger things down the road? And as far as politicians are concerned, MPs and senators,
not necessarily. I mean, you know, it's a question of their mentality.
If I get away with this, can I get away with something bigger?
No, I don't think that plays personally. I think they do wrong what they do wrong, but I don't think slippery slope doesn't apply to my domain. I don't think.
Yeah, it you know again, it's not something that I could say I've seen that happen,
mm-hmm.
right?
No.
People will get into certain practices you see it in some of the individual reports that we made on senators, where some of them get into certain practices. Some of them, you know, believe that those practices are okay. So, you know, it's not. I think it really is a personal. I think there are some people that those types of things could happen, but for others, it's just, you know, what they feel they should be allowed to put forward, right? It's just a mindset. It's not they've gotten there through a series of smaller events.
Necessarily.
Right.
No.
You know, we talk a lot about how Ottawa has become hyper-partisan. So in a weird way, it was almost heartening to see that the Senate scandal was decidedly a non-partisan affair in a way, in that there were alleged crooks on either side of the aisle, and I use the crooks colloquially, I assure you. You know, we had not only had Mike Duffy and Pamela Wong, Patrick Brazzo, et cetera, but also, you know, Mac Harb, who was a Christianite liberal, promoted to the Senate in 2013. You know, Duffy's own defense during the trial was essentially that, you know, everybody's doing it. Everybody was doing it. And as cynical as that is, I think there's probably something to it. You know, you look at that, the audit of refers to the 30 senators for further investigation to the RCMP. Of those 30, there were nine particularly more egregious cases, and it's instructive to look at the political leanings of those nine. Six were associated with the Liberal Party, three are associated with the Conservative Party. The NDP gets away with it because they've never had
they're not
the chance.
There.
They just hadn't had. They have. It's not that they're better. They just haven't had the chance. That's my opinion. Anyway, as well, you know, Mrs. Dawson has issued a number of reports finding ministerial staff in contravention, contravention of the Act and Code. Question for you, what sort of breaches have you found over the years?
Usually it's a misuse of their position in one way or another, preferential treatment to somebody. There's a few post-employment breaches where they've used their influence to get something they shouldn't have got. Basically, it's because most of them are founded on private interest. So it's where somehow they've either benefited themselves, their family, or somebody else using their position to do so, mm-hmm. and or using the fact that they have had a position. And so it's that's the fundamental. Gifts are an interesting case.
I was just going to ask you.
Yeah, gifts are the hardest one, hardest nut to crack in a sense, because you know, there's a feeling that, you know, if I'm given a gift, I'm allowed to keep it, sort of thing. And of course, the rule is if you're given a gift, if it could reasonably be seen to have been given to influence you, you cannot accept it. And I mean, my big case that came out about a year ago was the Bonner case. And that one, it's the first one that I've had about gifts, because generally, we get no end of information, or people have told us that they've been offered a gift. And if we tell them to pay for it or to give it back, they do it. I've never had a case where somebody's refused to do that. The problem is the cases that don't come to our attention.
Right.
And the Bonner case, there seems to be a failure to understand that if you're given a ticket to an event that's worth a certain amount of money, that's a gift. And but I what was really lovely about that case is that all of a sudden they noticed, and the lobbyists have gone crazy over this, because generally the lobbyists are the stakeholders that have been giving these gifts, of course, because they're the ones that want something. And I've had no end of calls and requests from the lobbying community for advice as to how they can manage who they give gifts to or who they don't, or who they can't give gifts to, or what's acceptable. So that, I mean, there have been a number of cases like that that I've felt have it's great that it happened, because I've got a vehicle to get a message out.
Right.
And but it seemed to come, interestingly, as a shock to the whole community. They never sort of realized they couldn't give these gifts, although the rule's there.
I'm actually unfamiliar with the rules. Is there a monetary limit to the types of gifts that you
No,
get?
Well, and there's constant confusion. There's a reporting requirement if it's worth more than $200, but that's a reporting requirement as opposed to an acceptability issue. So in other words, if you get a gift and you don't have to report it because it's worth $100, it will still, in all likelihood, if it's come from somebody that is looking for something from you, be seen to have been given to influence you. And I have a lot of trouble convincing people. I give this message all the time, and then it's forgotten a day later. There's a lot of confusion there, and I think it's because there's an inherent feeling that somehow, well, the argument I get back quite often is I can't be bought. It brings disgrace onto the government, onto the people that are governing us, and so they have a higher level of responsibility than the private sector, because they're using public money.
Right, and the other thing too is, like, I'm just thinking about it, and I'm trying to think that in terms of, like, people trying to buy you off and influence you, there's very few people that wouldn't be trying to do that if they happen to be living in your riding, if there's a business in your riding, or what have you. Everybody wants something from you, right?
Yeah. Now, I do make it's really quite a difficult area. I do say that, you know, an MP has responsibilities to their constituents, and they have a need to go to events that they're invited to. They can't be paying for every single event they go to. Mm-hmm. So that's a different situation from somebody in, I don't know, Shell Canada or something, having a reception or inviting them to a gala that's a $200 ticket or something, and giving it to the person if they're looking for something. But there has to be a situation where there is something that the government is going to do for them, or that the person that they're offering it to is going to do for them. And so those are different kind of issues than sort of audits of expenditures of money.
If a board is, Mr. Ferguson, if the Board of Internal Economy orders MPs to repay expenses, is there an enforcement mechanism? And can MPs be referred for further investigation, or is the Auditor General review necessary first?
Well, really, it's those, the Board of Internal Economy or the Internal Economy Committee in the Senate, they're the ones that have the authority to make the decision, mm-hmm. right? So mm-hmm. they're the ones that tell the member or the senator, whether what they claimed was appropriate or not, and they are the enforcement mechanism. Obviously,
just
no.
A classic problem.
Obviously, they don't have to. They don't have to wait for us to do anything. We don't have any mandate. In the cases that you mentioned of Wallen, Duffy, Harb, and Ambrazo,
yeah.
We didn't do any work on any of those. And in fact, when we looked at the 116 senators, we looked at. We left those ones out because the work had already been done.
Right.
Right. So, mm-hmm. So no, we really don't have any role in that at all. And in fact, in the report, we reported on 30 senators, 9 of which we recommended that the Internal Economy Committee refer to the RCMP. But that was only our opinion. Right. They could have decided out of the 30 how many to refer, and in actual fact, it didn't matter whether any were referred or not.
It was up to them.
Technically, the RCMP can look at the whole file themselves, mm-hmm. Now that the information's there, and they can decide themselves what they're interested in.
What are your feelings on those 4 cases, Wallen, Duffy, Harb, Brazo? Were they singled out because the what happened was particularly egregious? Were they unlucky? What was it that made them household names, do you think? I guess fundamentally, why them?
Well, it's probably I guess because the their situations came to light, right? People became aware of the details in their situation. Of the 9 that we recommended go forward to the RCMP, I believe it was 5 of them that we questioned their residency claim, mm-hmm. right? So that same issue about were they really resident in the place that they said they were. When we were looking at senators' expenses, one of the things that we looked at was the work that Deloitte's did when they looked at Senator Wallen's expenses and how they interpreted all of that, right? So we used that information ourselves to make sure, and the time period we looked at was sort of the same 2-year time period, where the problems arose for those people.
Right.
Because what we wanted to do through that audit was help people understand everything that went on with that time period with all of the senators applying all of the same rules. I don't know exactly why those cases came forward first. People became aware of them and the Senate reacted to them. Then through our work, I think we were able to bring forward the picture of everything that happened through that time period for all of the senators.
Hmm. One thing about those 4 is they're fairly high profile.
Yes.
The media would notice them.
Yes. Maybe. I just went through them and
yeah.
You're right.
Yeah.
I mean, 2 of them were high profile media people, former media people themselves.
Yeah. So the media would be interested.
Yeah. Very much so. I think we can all sort of agree that all sorts of rules and recommendations can be made, but ultimately it takes political will to implement them, and we touched on that earlier. The saddest example that I can think of this political will not happening isn't at the federal level. Personally, I think it's here in Quebec. We had the Charbonneau Commission, which came about because of what. With Mr. Jean Charest brought into place with great regret. He didn't want to do it. So anyway, we had this commission, and the commission did all sorts of investigations, came up with all sorts of findings. Among them, that the biggest construction companies in the province were basically colluding to price fix, specifically a fair bit in Montreal, Rive-Nord, Rive-Sud of Montreal, and that the more egregious thing was that they were, along with some of the biggest engineering firms in the province, were making illegal donations to political parties, by use of the straw man, basically giving their employees, making their employees donate money to the party and then reimbursing their employees, which is crooked beyond belief. And the biggest offender in all of this was the Liberal Party of Quebec. And yet, after a short minority stint with the Parti Québécois, we re-elected the Liberals regardless. Not too long ago, the Charbonneau Commission produced a report, and I saw it, it's like this. It's, I forget how many thousands of pages it is, and I can literally like hear it collecting dust right now. There is no political will to move forward on any of this, despite all the outrage that this generated. So I guess my question for you guys, to put it in the political realm, Ms. Dawson, do you believe there's political will on the part of the current federal government to do something, to continue doing things?
Well, I don't know. They certainly are making all the noises as if there is. And, you know, the thing is, once you put in a piece of legislation, though, I mean, my rules, I enforce. And so, therefore, there's no way around it if somebody contravenes the rules in the Conflict of Interest Act. But if it's not put into some sort of an act or something that somebody else is administering, then it's up for grabs, and one hopes that they will do what they say. So it's all a question of whether there's an enforcement mechanism of some sort or an accountability mechanism of some sort.
The audit called for independent oversight and, quote, transformational change in the way expenses are claimed, managed, controlled, and reviewed. It goes on to say, simply changing or adding to existing rules will not be enough. Improvements in oversight, accountability, transparency, and due regard are necessary. Mm-hmm. Do you think that's possible?
I absolutely think it's possible. We made the recommendations, and like I say, in the recommendations we made, we were fairly detailed in what we thought needed to be done. Improving transparency, more disclosure, putting in some independent oversight. You know, we're not talking about anything that is an impossible task. It's all very doable. It's sort of a matter of the political will. I'm not going to answer the question of whether I think the political will is there or not, because, you know, fundamentally, again, I'm an auditor, and auditors live in the past. We don't live in the future. So for us, it will be a matter of somewhere down the line, we will do an audit that will touch on some of these things.
And I'll ask you in 10 years.
And then I'll answer your question.
But again, as I said at the beginning, governments come in promising change, and often that change doesn't happen. And you mentioned, too, that, you know, you'd think they would have gotten to this point by now. What's preventing it?
I'm gonna duck your question here by changing the subject a bit. But, you know, I released a report on Tuesday, that talked about a number of different subjects. And, you know, one of the things that there are a few things that continue to surprise me every time we go in and do audits, right? One is the fact that when government departments are responsible for providing something to people, they don't look at it from the point of view of the person who's trying to get access to the service. They do some activities very well, but they don't say, you know, what does a person have to live through to do that, to get this service, right? So we looked at the Canada Pension Plan Disability Program, for example, and there's 42 pages worth of application that you have to get through just to put your application forward. And we see that time and again. We had an audit a while back on access for veterans to mental health services. Same type of thing, right? A long time to be able to get an application done, right? So there's just, you know, you look at these and you say, well, why does that keep happening? You know, it's the same question.
Right.
Looking at, you know, other things that go on in government. The number of times we go in and we do an audit, and we say, okay, you know, let's get some information about this area so that we can, you know, figure out what's going on, and we'll go and we'll look at their computer system that captures information around the program. And, you know, you look at a number of our audits, and we will say that the information they're capturing in their systems is oftentimes not accurate. So, you know, you can't really use the data they're capturing to make an assessment. And we're now in the world of big data, right? You know, you would think that data quality would be a fundamental. So, you know, the way that you just shook your head is the way, you know, that's what I do. I shake my head over, you know, why can't they get data quality right in systems? Why can't they, why can't programs be administered from the point of view of let's provide the best service to the recipient? And why can't you put in better transparency, accountability?
Across the, right.
You know, it's all the same. You know, all those things make me shake my head.
So answer the question.
I don't even remember what it was now.
Why can't you?
Well, I don't know. I don't know why it isn't happening. It's just, you know, I guess what I'm trying to get at is it's a symptom of a bigger problem, right? Because it's not just in the transparency and accountability of members. It's also a similar problem of, you know, things that are fixable that should be in better shape than they are, but for some reason they're not.
You use the term transformational change. What does that mean?
Well, you know, I mean, transformational, I guess from the point of view of now's the time to put the emphasis on, you know, it's got to be about accountability. It's got to be about transparency. It's got to be about having a system where people say, yes, okay, we think that those decisions are made in an objective manner. And you know, that's it, you know, that the decisions that are going to be made are made with due regard for economy and helping people, you know, get that confidence. You know, we spend a lot of time and effort, which translated into a lot of money, doing that audit of the Senate. And
which you got a little bit of grief for.
Which we got grief, yeah, right. What we got grief for. But
justice ain't free.
we wouldn't, you know, if they had had the systems in place, we wouldn't have had to go in and do all of the work that we had to do. But what we were able to do with that piece of work was we were able to, I think, set the record straight, right? So that people knew, okay, this is what happened with all of those senators over that course of time. So, you know, again, I think it's really important to put in place those types of systems, and the transformation has to be to that culture of we're going to be accountable, we're going to be transparent, and we're going to be able to show people that the decisions are made in an objective manner.
Yeah, and I guess the takeaway, the optimistic takeaway from that is basically they certainly don't have an excuse now. Given the work that's gone into it.
Right, and again, we put we put a number of recommendations forward. You know, we think that they were quite prescriptive to help them understand the way forward. So, you know, I think the roadmap's there.
There we go. We're just going to move to a couple questions from the audience. The first is for Ms. Dawson. I thought it was a good one. How has the concept of ethics evolved over time? And are there differences in management of ethics and integrity versus other jurisdictions? But that first part, how has the concept of ethics evolved over time in your position?
Interesting because my position actually, whereas I'm called the Conflict of Interest and Ethics Commissioner, there's no mention of ethics in my act.
So you're unethical?
No. There's just no mention of ethics. What there is mention of is conflict of interest. Mm-hmm. And ethics is so much broader a term than conflict of interest. So I'm not sure I can comment on that particularly because ethics is in life. It's in everything. And it's in how polite you are to different people. It's into every sort of manner of interface. And I think... I don't think it's changed. I don't think it's gotten better or gotten worse. It's just your interrelationship with people and your way of behaving. With respect to conflict of interest, I mean that's the more precise thing that I'm dealing with, and I think that people are gradually getting used to the rules that there are and that the situation is getting better. So, I mean, it's a difficult question to answer that ethics one because it's such a broad concept.
I like that. I'm glad to hear that things are getting better. And
it's
heartening. You
know, I think so.
In all seriousness. It's,
yeah. I mean, the trouble is you hear about the people that have offended the rules. You don't hear about all the people that are trying so hard to comply with the rules. And
yeah, that's my fault.
Believe me, I get, we people are very good. I get constantly calls, both from the people that have left for their post-employment rules and for the people that are in. Just, they want to be very careful they don't offend the rules. Now, part of that's because they don't want to be politically in trouble. But I also think there's a desire to do the right thing.
Either way, it gets done.
Yeah.
Mr. Ferguson, do you think you will be invited to audit MP expenses, and do you see it as an area of potential cooperation between you and the Conflict of Interest and Ethics Commissioner's Office?
You know, we're on record as saying that we would like to have a mandate to, you know, play a role in an audit of in the audit structure, I guess, around MPs' expenses. You know, I would not recommend that that be the same type of thing that we did around senators, where you know, because when what we looked at with the senators was, we looked at every single thing they spent for a 2-year period, right? What there needs to be is a regular audit regime that would be, you know, how audits are usually conducted in terms of, you know, taking samples of spending, and it be something that goes on all of the time. And we're certainly, you know, more than happy to, you know, play a role in that. You know, in terms of sort of cooperation, you know, there are our roles, right? I'm an agent of Parliament. How do you refer to
yourself?
Well,
an officer of Parliament.
You're part of Parliament.
Actually, that's something
I'm an agent of Parliament, so yeah. I'm not actually part of Parliament. And there are a number of other agents of Parliament as well, right? There's a lobbying commissioner, there's the official languages commissioner, there's the privacy commissioner, there's the information commissioner, you know, there's Elections Canada, there's a lot of other people that have oversight roles related to, you know, what goes on sort of in government. So, you know, there are often times where we will end up in a situation where we say, you know what, this is something that, you know, looks like it's a bit of our role, but it looks like it's a bit of somebody else's role as well. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I can't come up with an exact example where mm-hmm. sort of we might collaborate mm-hmm. on something, mm-hmm. but, you know, if the situation arose, yeah. you know, we would talk to each other and say, you know, who should handle it? Well, maybe we should both handle part of it or whatever, right?
Yeah, but actually we haven't had a situation
no.
like that in years.
Right.
The two roles here don't interface particularly.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess, yeah, they're yeah. more, they're aligned but not politically aligned.
Yeah, so it wouldn't be precluded.
There's different types
right?
of issues we're looking at.
Right.
Yeah.
Ms. Dawson, do you think there should be satellite offices like yours in the provinces or even locally? I think there are some locally, but in the provinces.
Well, the provinces each have their own ethics commissioner. So
across the board?
Yes, every single province and every territory has an ethics commissioner. We actually have a group that meets once a year to compare notes and just discuss stuff. So I'm not quite sure where that question is coming from.
I didn't
with respect
realize that it was every province. That every
yeah,
province
no, had. So I don't look after the provincial government's ethics. I look after the federal government's mm-hmm. ethics. But there'd be no real need for me to have people in across the country because the people that there are some people that aren't in Ottawa, but not sufficient numbers that there's any
right.
sense. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Actually, just you know, if I can just pick up on that a little bit, you know, in terms of auditors general, there are auditors general in each of the provinces, but actually we also are the auditor general for each of the three northern territories. So we have our role is, you know, we do audits federally and we report to Parliament. But we also do audits in each of the three northern territories, and we report to their territorial legislatures.
How come?
Mm-hmm.
It's just the way that that's been. That you know, it's historic. It's just been the way that it's been set up. I think the territories are probably quite happy with it because it all comes out of the budget we get.
I was just going to say, yeah.
Federally.
Yeah.
It's sort of like the RCMP.
I was just, yeah, exactly.
Which does some of the policing for some of the provinces.
Yeah.
It's just a convenience thing.
Right.
Yeah.
Mr. Ferguson, you're probably not going to answer this, but what are the audits planned for the future?
You can go to our website, actually.
Yeah. www.
We plan out about 3 years. I believe on our website we disclose at least one forward. I'm not sure. It might even be two forwards. You know, so there is some information that we have there. The next, this year, you know, is going to be a bit unusual because, you know, like I said, we just released a report on Tuesday, but that was really the fall report from last year,
right,
which we held because of the election. So we will release another one in May, and then we will release another one in the fall. You know, and we have one underway, for example, on the Army Reserves. We have one underway on some of the controls around citizenship. So, I mean, we've got some audits underway in a number. You know, I mentioned that we had done an audit in the past on government and council appointments, and we have a follow-up audit that looks at one aspect of that as well. So, you know, the last report that I issued was, I think, seven audits. The one in May is probably five, and then probably back to five or six in the fall again. So we've always got lots of audits underway.
Ms. Dawson, do you think that the Office of the Conflict of Interest and Ethics, we've touched on this a little bit, but do you think your office has made MPs more ethical or improved the overall integrity of Parliament? You just say yes.
It certainly made them more aware.
Yeah.
More aware, and they're coming for advice a lot more. Every year there's more and more people coming for advice. Hmm. So I think we're raising the profile of the issues. Hmm. Yeah.
Another question for you. If you had a choice, what new powers would you seek, and how would they be enforced?
You know, I actually have a very strong set of powers. I think the changes that I would be suggesting is to the rules. I have the power to advise. I have the power to gather the information. I have the power to investigate. The only power that I don't have is to penalties out. I have some penalties in my act for failures to meet deadlines,
okay,
but administrative penalties. I'm actually not an advocate of penalties particularly. I think that the reports are the important thing, because whatever will happen to the person as a result of the report will happen. But I don't think asking them to pay for it makes a difference. That's where the Canadian model is quite different from the American model, which in some areas of the states, they have heavy, heavy penalties for some of these infractions. I don't think that's the point. There are those that would disagree with me. So therefore, I and of course with the House of Commons, constitutional issue there as to whether anybody can impose a penalty on the House of Commons,
right,
with respect to the members. But with respect to the public office holders, you know, if they wanted to, I had something like 97 recommendations for amendments to the Act, and I had about 30 to amendments to the Code. So there's lots of amendments that I would propose. To my delight, 10 of them were actually actioned last June and put into force as of October. So that was very good. So it's in the rules that I would look for something stronger, not in my powers. I think I've got all the powers I need.
Wow.
She's for my role.
last question to you, and you touched on it a little bit, just the role of the media and that kind of thing. During the height of the Senate scandal, there was some pushback from various senators who said that this is a witch hunt. Like it's almost like a self-fueling fireball. It gets bigger and bigger, and that everybody is assumed guilty. Do you think there's anything to that? Do you think that there is a tendency to witch hunt in the type of work that you do?
No, you know, and quite frankly, absolutely not. You know, we spend a lot of time talking to senators to understand their business. I mean, audits are, you know, people don't like audits, right? But audits happen.
You should put that on a T-shirt.
You know, I mean, you've got to, you know, you're looking at things, you're asking people questions, you know, but we spent a lot of time, you know, making sure that we were we were understanding things, right? I think the famous one that came up through the whole thing was senators that didn't like the fact that we were asking them about, when they claimed a per diem at the same time that they were at an event, that provided a meal, or,
yeah,
you know, they were on an airplane that provided a meal or whatever, right?
Cold camembert.
So we were exploring all of those situations just to try to understand what was going on and why they would claim, right? So we asked a lot of questions about a lot of things. But at the end of the day, we reported on the things that we thought, were not appropriate to claim. We asked about a lot of them. Again, we had to go into that. Normally in an audit, we would have gone in and said, okay, we're going to take a sample of claims and we're going to give the results of that sample. But we knew in the environment we were working in that people would not accept samples, right? People wanted to know about every dollar that was spent. We didn't want to get to the end of this and have people come out and say, oh yeah, but we know there's still more, right? Mm-hmm. So we feel that what we did was, and if you look at the report we issued, there's two parts to it. There's the front part, which talks about all of the stuff you talked earlier, the transformational change side. And then there's the back part that talks about the 30 senators, right? Really, for us, what it was about was, okay, we need to find out what happened with all of the 116 senators that we looked at. Everybody needs to say, okay, now we know that situation. But what's important is dealing with it going forward, right? You know, how do we deal with all of that front part of the report and put the right system in place? So, we did that work on the 116 senators because we knew it had to be done, and that's what people wanted to know. But for us, really, what's going to have the bigger impact, I hope, will in fact be, this is what you need to do to change. Mm-hmm. And that's really what, where we see the value in the work was in that this is what you need to do to change. So we absolutely did not walk into that with a witch hunt mentality.
That was our role.
Yeah. The media likes bad news.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
And on that note, thanks very much, guys. I really appreciate it. Mr. Ferguson, Mary Dawson, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.